With national development gain more and more importance and demand for constant valuation of the role played by the generators of the scientific technological knowledge, research institutions and universities. In an internationalized world where commercial boundaries are left behind by virtue of multilateral agreements, support for the production of new knowledge and priority given to collective apprenticeship are sine qua non conditions for the sustainable development of a nation in a new worldwide economical system. The relations between the state and scientific technological organizations have to be strengthened and permitted by the ethical values and moral commitments. I applaud the effort of Dr. Reena, Assistant Professor, Department of Chemistry, and her team for organizing such a webinar where we are talking about science and technology, which is directly needed at this cutthroat competition in this field. I wish Dr. Reena and Dr. Irfana for taking pains to make this webinar a grand success. Thanking you.
N.K. Tripathi, sir. Over
yes.
To you. Welcome, sir. My
patron of this organized webinar, Professor Dr. Jalaluddin Ansari of Gaya, and chairman of this webinar, Mr. Shamsi, all the speakers, especially the keynote speaker and the chief speaker, all the participants, and of course Dr. Reena, who is the link between me and this webinar. First of all, I congratulate the chemistry department of chemistry, Mirza Ghalib College, Gaya, for organizing such a meaningful seminar or webinar to discuss on the issue of science and technology for human health and what are the global priorities. Role of science and technology for human health, global priority. That is the exact theme of this webinar. As is evident, human health, as far as the human beings are concerned, the human health is the most important factor in his life, in his or her life, because without health there cannot be any progress at personal level and at the social level. And health includes mental health, physical health, enthusiasm to work, and all the physical abilities of the various parts of the body. That is sum total of the human health. And this human health has, if you want to promote it, if you want to maintain it, if you want to develop it, it can clearly be divided into two parts. One is the preventive part of health, where the health can be maintained by creating certain environment. And second, in case if anything goes wrong, there must be proper treatment for medicals through medical sciences. As you know, no discipline of science can work in isolation these days. Every discipline of the science, or if for that matter even arts, are totally interdependent on each other, and they benefit from the experiences of others, from the accomplishment of others. For example, medical sciences could not have progressed without the help of physics as far as the invention of stethoscope is concerned, X-ray, all these technology, instruments which came for the help of medical sciences, that has contributed to human health. Similarly, if we see the technology, it can also be useful for preventive purposes. For example, the science has now enabled us to examine all the diseases on a cellular level. On a cellular level, we can examine the diseases and provide antibodies against them. These are the vaccines which can be used for prevention of so many diseases, including the latest which we are facing in, unfortunately, in 2020, this COVID-19. This will also be contained very shortly, I hope, through the intervention of the technology by creating vaccine. Similarly, there are many instruments like CT scan, MRI, and many other, even robots, they are coming for operations and for other very precise working. These robots are also very useful for advancement of medical sciences. But human health is not only medical sciences, because medical science is the intervention when something goes wrong. In India, we know that we are hardly spending 1% on our health services, which includes the preventive medicine. In India, we are hardly spending any amount of money on R&D as compared to the other developed countries, or even our neighbor like China. We are not spending that much of money. So, we are dependent on the technology and the advancement from the Western countries. But coming back to the prevention of the health, prevention of the diseases, so that the health improves. We know malnutrition is the biggest problem. Immunization programs have to be there for children. If we are talking about the people living in far off places in India, in tribal areas, in remote places, their children are mostly, they are either wasted or they are undernourished. There we have to go in, the state has to go in and do some good work for providing help to these people for creating good health. I will not waste much of time for the other speakers, because basically I'm not a technical man, as told by my esteemed colleague. I would like to say that the link between this webinar and me, Doctor, she is member of my Jan Parishad, that is an organization which is working for environment, and we know providing health is, even maintaining health depends upon clean water and clean air. They are the sustainable development objectives which is projected by UN. These are very important objectives, so that everyone is entitled to have clean water and clean air. And it's only science and technology which can ensure in this world to provide this clean water to everyone at the doorstep, and nice fresh breeze air everyone to breathe. With these words, once again I congratulate and thank and express my gratitude to the organizer of this webinar, and I hope this webinar will go and will become a milestone in the field of this thinking. Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for your valuable suggestion and your opinion. We are really thankful to you, sir, for taking the time of his busy schedule to attend the webinar and providing us a knowledgeable speech to us. It is very very beneficial for all of us and all the participants, students of the Mirza Ghalib College. Thanks once again, sir. I would like to introduce our next chief speaker, Dr. Sukhvinder Singh Sibia. It's my pleasure to introduce him on this webinar. I feel extremely honored to introduce the chief speaker, Dr. S.S. Sibia, who is a medical specialist in Sibia Medical Heart Hospital. He is also a member of European Association of Preventive Cardiology, European Association of Cardiovascular Imaging. He is a member of Acute Cardiovascular Care Association. He is a member of Heart Failure Association, American College for Advancement in Medicine, Academy of Cardiovascular Cartography, Indian Academy of Neuroscience, Indian Medical Association, Association of Physicians of India, World Anti-Aging Network, Indian Society for Clinical and Experimental Hypnosis. He is a fellowship of Academy of Cardiovascular Cartography. He is a secretary photographic society of Rajendra Medical College. He is the winner of Annual College of Sports in 1978. He has been awarded photography award first prize shoot BIT 78. He is a runner up Annual College of Sports in Carom Double 1977. He is a member college cricket team 1975-77. He was a vice president of Science Club 1970. He was a winner of chess tournament 1968. Sir, Dr. S.S. Sibia has an academic publication and he is author, co-author. His book is Conquering Heart Disease. He has wrote foreword for a short story book by Dr. R.S. Bhatia. He has written chapter on ESP in Holistic Wellness in the New Age. His media cover over 1,000 times in newspapers and magazine, India Today, Life Gazette, Sarika, Kadambini, etc. He has worked experience of medical officer, various Punjab government hospital and health center since 1981 to 1994. He was senior consultant and lithotripsy Ludhiana Hospital. He was lecturer in LMH Medical College Ludhiana. He was visiting physician Asian Chelation Therapy Center, New Delhi. He was assistant professor in Department of Medicine, MM Medical College and Hospital. He is a consultant physician. Currently, he is a consultant physician and heart cardiologist, Sibia Medical Center, Ludhiana. Dr. Sibia achieved lots of achievement and contribution. He has been invited for panel discussion on ethical sustainable healthcare in British House of Parliament, London, on 12th September 2017. He is referred to as a father of chelation therapy in India for introducing chelation therapy in the country. He has been awarded Global Healthcare Excellence Award for West Institute for Non-Surgical Heart Treatment in India for demonstrating innovation, dedication, creativity and excellence in the healthcare 2014. He is running a leading center in no-surgery treatment where patients from over 35 countries have been placed their faith for the treatment. Is a co-scientific international study on asthma and allergic in childhood 1994. He has introduced lithotripsy, ESWL, for removal of a stone in year 1990s. Currently, he is working on artery clearance therapy, chelation therapy, ozone therapy, hydrogen peroxide therapy, cardiovascular cartography, vasculography, heart flow mapping, external counter pulsation, a spinal posture correction, and back problems with computerized spinal table. I welcome Dr. S. S. Sivia sir to provide us his lecture and knowledgeable information on this webinar. Dr. S. S. Sivia sir.
Thank you, Dr. Reena. Thank you, Dr. Reena, for the elaborate introduction you have given and for arranging to invite me to this webinar on role of science and technology on human health, a global priority. With due respect to all the seniors sitting here attending this webinar, Dr. Tripathi, Dr. Jalaluddin, Dr. Shabi Shamshi, Dr. Sujat Ali, and others, it is my pleasure to be over here. We are talking of science. And when Dr. Tripathi said that he is not on medical field, I will say it is not just science. We have to consider the wisdom and science together. Science is only one aspect when we come to the various modes of treatment. Without wisdom, it would really be a catastrophe. So with all the wise words said by Dr. Tripathi and others, I must accept that their wisdom has a greater role than that of science. So without that wisdom, science can always go astray. One example of that is when we are talking of nuclear use for warfare. When we use it for warfare or we use it for peaceful means and for treatment, it all depends on the wisdom of the people behind it. Science is hope for the patients. And this is possible only when we associate it with the wisdom. I'll share the screen. Is the screen visible?
Yes, sir.
Right. We are often blinded by our own choice. And this blindness is due to the science being ahead of the wisdom. So we have to balance between the wisdom and the science to really take the maximum benefit of it. Science is progress, it is the future, it is what humanity depends upon. But we have to keep an open mind. Only then science will be able to progress. There are so many things which have been invented, so many things scientific which have been thought about, which have been the scientists have worked so hard on it, but because many of us are blinded, we have not let that aspect of science progress. Hence, we have to ensure that we are not just using the science. We should also be not blinded, and we should think of it in a more progressive manner. So we have to keep our eyes open, and we have to dare to keep it open So all the newer things that science gives us, we are able to put it to good human use. Specifically treating of coming to what I am doing, we are trying to treat heart disease other than by surgery and stents. In fact, I personally believe that surgery and stent should be the alternatives when the other treatments which are non-surgical, non-invasive, when they fail. There have been many breakthroughs in science, and we have to break through our mental barriers also. These are some of them: the ECP, the TMR, ESMR, PEMF, chelation, ozone, biooxidative medicine. These are other sciences which have developed to treat heart patients without surgery, and not just what we now commonly know, the stent, the bypass, and the angioplasty. Everything is energy, as Albert Einstein said, and that's all there is to it. We can convert mass into energy. So it means that anything can be converted into energy. And if we are able to use that energy, that vibration properly, we can achieve anything. We can make or break anything, and we can treat most diseases. The electromagnetic spectrum has got, I put it as two groups. One is what is visible to us and what is audible to us. The other is where the frequency is such that the ultraviolet light, X-rays, gammas, and others which are more or less harmful. The nuclear warfare all comes into this category. The other side is the infrared, the ultrasound, the microwave, the radio waves, the television, the cytotron. These are the safe wavelengths in the electromagnetic spectrum which can be used for treating patients, for communication, and for development of humanity, and for peaceful means. One such thing is shockwave, which is, as I call it, it is treating patients with physics. In this, a high voltage creates an electric spark discharge. The water in the immediate vicinity, it vaporizes, creates an explosion, and this explosion caused is focused onto the area of the heart which is having less blood supply, to stimulate it to produce new blood vessels. This same technology has been used depending on what frequency and what strength of the frequency. At one end is the lithotripsy, in which with the shock waves we are able to break kidney stones so they pass out through the urine. Then in orthopedics, it can be used to treat joint pains. It can be used to increase blood flow to the legs. In cardiology, it is used for ischemic heart disease. It is also used in erectile dysfunction, and the latest is to use it for kidney diseases. This is what the equipment looks like. This is CardioSpec, the equipment used for treating heart disease without surgery, with ultrasonic waves focused onto the myocardium. Here, an ultrasound machine specific for the heart, that is known as echocardiography, is used to enable us to focus the shock waves onto the myocardium. This is a control panel. ECG monitoring is done at the same time. This is the shockwave applicator. This is the unit which produces the shockwaves. So this is a bigger image of that. This is the shockwave generator applicator. which focuses onto the myocardial, the ischemic zones. This is another image of the same. The electrode, the spark is produced here. This is focused by this ellipsoid onto the ischemic zone of the myocardium. With each session of the treatment, we see the angiogenesis, that is development of new blood vessels. There is an immediate effect, that is production of nitric oxide synthetase, and the long-term effect is the angiogenesis. This is what we can see, that newer blood vessels grow up, and when they grow, they supply blood to the ischemic areas. Who can benefit with this new technology? Those in refractory angina, that is those patients who, in spite of the best medication, they are still having chest pain and other features of angina, ischemic heart failure. What we call is a no option patient, that is those patients. Those patients who are not fit for angioplasty, stent or bypass, or those patients who have had a recurrence after these treatments. For all these patients, ESMR is a very useful technology. Like any other treatment, ESMR also has certain contraindications where it should not be used. After treatment, we find that most patients, their angina episodes become fewer or they disappear altogether. Then, if any angina, it is less painful. Patients can walk longer distance without chest pain, return to work, lead an active life again. The quality of life increases and the medication also decreases. We can also test the patient with treadmill test. This is angiography where we can see that in this zone where there are no visible small blood vessels, they have grown over here. This is the control, and this is after the shock waves, the increase in the number of capillaries per square millimeter. This is clinical improvement in the breathlessness and New York Heart Association classification of angina. Left ventricle fraction improvement. This is basically, you can say, the efficiency of the heart pump increases. After myocardial infarction, there is decrease in the movement of the myocardium because the heart muscle becomes weak. This improves with ESMR. This is again the Canadian classification of angina, improvement in that. 61% show improvement in the exercise time. 18.5% has improvement in oxygen uptake. In the nuclear studies, we can see that there is increase in the blood flow as compared to the previous images. This is again the SPECT study. This is a very interesting equipment which non-invasively from outside, it gives us an idea of the blood flow to different parts of the myocardium. We can see that these areas which had decreased blood flow, they are now having normal blood flow after treatment. The advantages of non-invasive treatments, it can be ESMR, ECB or any other treatment which is non-invasive, non-surgical, is that it is more comfortable, painless, no anesthesia is required, and it is safer than the surgical treatments. And of course, most of them do not require any hospitalization. They can be repeated any number of times, and they can complement almost all other available treatments. They can be done with or before or after stents and bypass, etc. So science is hope, and hope is all that human being is living for. Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you, Dr. Reena.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir, for sharing your valuable information. Some of the participant wants to ask some questions, sir. Yes, they have some confusion.
Yes, yes.
Sania Nasim, she wants to ask, myocardial blood flow from where? She has one question about.
No, can you repeat the question, please? It's not clear.
From where myocardial blood flow from? What is the source of myocardial blood flow?
Yeah, the myocardial blood flow comes from the coronary arteries. There are three coronary arteries which supply blood to the myocardium through the capillaries.
Okay.
So when these capillaries, all these capillaries form a network. So when we are able to increase this network with ESMR or ECP or other treatments, the heart muscle, that is the myocardium, gets increased blood flow.
Okay, sir. Thank you. Sir, one of the question is, what is, we have listened the advantages of ESMR technique. What participant wants to know disadvantages of ESMR technique.
Disadvantages?
Yes, sir.
There are no disadvantages of ESMR if the patient is selected properly. For example, if a patient has got severe lung disease, then it should not be done. There's inadequate research in patients, ladies who may be pregnant. So again, it should not be done. Other, there should be some amount of viable myocardium for the blood flow to be effective. As such, when we talk of disadvantages, there is no serious disadvantage with ESMR. It is safe, and no mortality or morbidity has been reported with use of ESMR.
Okay, sir. Sir, according to sir, there is a alternative of heart surgery, that is ESMR, through which where blood is not following, flowing in the heart, through ESMR technique, blood flow increases in that portion of the heart. And new blood vessel also produced in a heart. So it is one of the alternate of blood heart surgery. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
I would like to invite Dr. Harpreet Kaur Sivia, ma'am. First, I would like to introduce her. She is a consultant in a CBM Medical Center. She has been a medical officer in Punjab Civil Medical Services since 1986 to 1991. She has been director and lithotripsy specialist, Ludhiana Stone Clinic from 1991 to 2003. She is now consultant in Sevilla Medical Center from 1994 to till date. She is a membership of Indian Medical Association. Ma'am has attended various training refresher courses reorientation programs, updates, seminars, etc. She is a member of Geriatric Society of India. She is a member of Indian Society for Radiation Biology. Ma'am has work experience. She has been working Punjab Civil Medical Services as a medical officer. She has introduced extra corporeal soft wave lithotripsy ESWL in North India in 1991. She has introduced ACT, that is artery clearance therapy, chelation therapy, in 1994 for non-invasive treatment of coronary artery disease for patients who are unfit for coronary artery bypass surgery. She has introduced cardiovascular cartography in North India in 2000. She has introduced external counter pulsation, that is ECP and EECP, in North India in 2002 to create heart bypass naturally. She has introduced cyclotron therapy for arthritis in 2006. Madam has introduced cyclotron therapy for cancer in 2007. She has introduced bio-oxidative medicine and ozone therapy. She has started preventive and rehabilitation program for heart patients through patient education and combining modern medical management with alternative therapies of yoga, meditation, etc. to eliminate the factors causing disease and bring about reversal of coronary heart disease through essential lifestyle changes. Ma'am, I welcome on the web seminar organized by Mirza Ghalib College, Gaya, Bihar. Madam, over to you.
Thank you. First of all, I thank Principal Ansari and Tripathi and Reena and all the faculty involved in this webinar and inviting me for this lecture. I am really thankful to you, and I think this will enlighten people about the heart problems and the role of science. How physics and chemistry, they work together in the medical line and they help the patients. Heart disease, you know, is very common, starts with blood pressure, and gradually from blood pressure, diabetes and on, ultimately with increasing age, one gets trapped into it. And with increasing stress in this lifestyle and bad habits, the problem is increasing. And normally we have, first of all, the lifestyle management to get rid of the disease, followed by chemistry coming to our help. We start with some medication for the blood pressure, and we try to control it. And at times we are negligent, and when we are negligent, the problem increases, and gradually the size of the heart increases, or there is some obstruction, or we say blocks formation, and normally we call it blockages. The blockages, when they increase to bigger size, then they cause the decreased blood flow. And once the flow decreases, we have chest pain, angina, and that we normally feel some pain in the center of the chest, or it may be some referred pain in the jaw or in the arm, and that pain normally wears off once we take some rest. And to get rid of this, we need some lifestyle management, then some medicines, and once some medicines are not helpful, we move on to next health, and that is we think of some investigations like TMT or ECG, and to obviously heart is an important organ and it is a vital organ, and we know that it can give certain problems, and certain problems need to be, you know, taken care of with other devices. Then we come, you know, we need help of other things. Right now, Dr. Sibia, he talked about ESMR, that is extracorporeal revascularization of the blood vessels that increases the blood flow to the myocardium, that is heart muscle. And what I am talking about, going to talk about, is ECP, external counterpulsation. And ECP, you know, first of all, we have some natural history as an artery develops blocks and causes increasing blockages. Body compensates by expanding tiny branches, collaterals, to make it possible for blood to detour round blockages. Problem arises when collaterals are not enough to restore circulation, because development of collateral circulation is a gradual process. All do not have same natural ability to develop collaterals. And then here comes role of ECP, external counterpulsation, to create collaterals naturally. That is also called natural bypass. Natural bypass because you see, like, this is the infarct area, the area where there is decreased blood supply, or maybe some part is dead. And once this is a blockage and the area fed by that artery is not getting supply, so we need to bypass this zone, and through collaterals we increase the blood flow to this area so that there is proper oxygenation and the patient doesn't feel angina and chest pain and the related problems. Next slide. So the no option patient. The no option patient we call when patient doesn't want bypass. Bypass is a massive surgery, or he has already undergone bypass, and then there is ballooning and stent. The population of patients in the angina and no conventional treatment option is, and now no conventional treatment option is increasing. People don't want that hectic treatments. You know, they are scared of bypass and they don't want this, but they are unfit. Problem is patients unfit for interventional procedures like bypass, angiography, angioplasty or stenting, and patients with failed intervention procedures or failed intervention means they have already had a stent or bypass, there is a reblockage, or after the 5-7 years of bypass, there is again the angina, or patient is getting breathless, or walk capacity is decreasing, and he wants some relief from that. And once a bypass, the second bypass is always more risky, and they don't want the procedure again. Then next is patients with post-intervention reference. So this is something similar to that. The people had a bypass, they were okay for 5-7 years, and after that gradually the dose of medicine increases, the capacity of the patient is decreasing, they can't walk anymore, and they can't, they have lesser capacity to work capacity. And then next is patients not wanting intervention procedures, and someone, you know, who feels that he's got a very less problem, very less chest pain, and very less exertional dyspnea. Dyspnea is breathlessness, or exertion only is feeling some pain, and they don't want to go in for bypass right now, they want to delay it. You know, they don't feel that the problem is that much, that big, that there should be a major procedure of bypass. Then next is patients not affording intervention procedures. This is also a big category in our country because India is economically not very flourishing country. We have many poor people also who don't afford expensive bypass or interventions. Then we have options, some options for no option patients. So some cheaper options, some comfortable options, and some better options, I'll say, because they are better, because they are cheaper and their results are very good. So what is the answer? Answer is ECP. ECP, we see, is external counterposition, and this is ECP is the short form for that. ECP is an FDA approved treatment documented to increase blood supply to the heart by 20 to 42%. Remember, 20 to 40% increase is a very, very big number in medical science, and this, with this much improvement, person can get rid of medicines and they normally have a normal life. You know, they can eat well, they can sleep well, they can work and do their task in the home, and they can have a normal life. Though they can very high exertion is not possible. So here is ECP, external counterposition. This is the generic name. And EECP, ASECP, EECP is enhanced external counterposition. ASECP is something like Life Pulse, Cardio Assist, etc. These are the brand names. And these are life-saving procedures. This is how a patient is lying, and you see a doctor sits next to him, and the command is given by the computer. And then something about ECP. ECP, external, outside the body, no catheter surgeries or lasers. And then counter, it raises diastolic and lower systolic blood pressure. And counter means that raises the diastolic and lowers the systolic blood pressure. And then the pulsation is a pulsation fashion, in a pulsating manner. Gradually, first this, then this, next cuff, they inflate and deflate in a systematic manner, as commanded by the ECP feeding in the machine. And then it is very effective. Effective is because people feel very good, clinically tested. People, many scientific studies have been done, and they have proved that how before and after there was improvement in the ECP and TMT and even endotracheally the flow has been seen. Then it is non-surgical because there is no injection, there is no medicine given, and patient simply lies on the bed. Non-surgical, non-invasive, and non-pharmaceutical. No medicine is given by mouth or injected, or drip is given, and there is no anesthesia. So obviously the risk associated with anesthesia, that is not there, and there is no hospital stay. This is no work loss. Where a patient comes for the treatment is, this is normally we call it a lunch break treatment, because it takes 2 hours, 1 hour session, half an hour is before the preparation, and half an hour after the session, patient is just simply watched for any good or bad effect, and then they can go home. So no hospital stay. This is a day treatment, and can be done as an OPD procedure. And then it is economical. Economical also because the patient can pay for sitting, and as you know, in between can have some rest also. On weekend, there is no treatment. This is a 5 days in a week. The patient goes in for the treatment, and this is safe and well tolerated. Safe, obviously, because no medicine is going in, and the computers are working on the patient and giving the commands to the various cuffs. When there is little else medical science can offer, this gives a very good hope. you know, external counterpollination has applications for many diseases relevant to India, particularly cardiac disease. Now the treatment is available in most of the leading hospitals of the world in India. ECP is available at CBR Medical Center. This is a place where I work. This is my center, Ludhiana, Northern India. You know, besides Escort Heart Institute, and we were even Dr. APJ Kalam, he mentioned about us in International Cardiology Second World Congress. Then approved, you know, approvals are there. It is FDA USA approved and CE certified by Europe, and then it's UK National Drug Authority China. So in India, we don't have any important authority to approve the procedure, and they normally follow what FDA USA approves. And it is mentioned in journals, many journals, you know, Journal of the American College of Cardiology, Cardiovascular Reviews, Reports, Cardiology, Clinical Cardiology, Journal of Critical Illness, Journal of External Counterpollution, etc. There are many papers published in indexed medical journals, and they have shown the, you know, how the improvement is in such patients before and after ECP. So it is mentioned in textbooks also. In the Harrison is one of the principles of internal medicine. Its edition 16 includes, you know, reference of ECP and how the new, you know, it enhances coronary blood flow. Recent trials have shown that regular application improves angina exercise capacity and traditional myocardial perfusion. And then Ron Wald also has good words and suggested. And then let's go to patient selection and what are the indications, why, you know, why to have it or in whom. Coronary artery disease is the thing. You know, any patient, any person having coronary artery disease, that is heart problem, that has angina, patients not fit for surgery, those who do not want surgery or angioplasty by choice, you know, then they may be fit, but they don't want by choice. And then we have failed or reblock after angioplasty or bypass surgery. And then we have patients who wanted to improve cardiac status before surgery. They want, before going in for major bypass surgery, let's get some, you know, strength to the heart, and they're going for sessions of ECP and preventive for persons at high risk of heart disease and congestive heart failure. So, you know, first thing first, this is non-invasive and this is comfortable. So before going in for major surgery, people also, some people prefer it. Then other non-cardiac indications, it increases the blood supply to the heart and improves the myocardial perfusion. But along with that, other parts of the body also benefit with it. And the first is cerebral ischemia, that is when blood supply to the brain is less. And you know, thrombosis or lacunar infarction, pain injury due to trauma or toxic gas inhalation, transient ischemic attacks, that is when we have patients of blackout or something, and senile dementia, cerebral ataxia, Parkinsonism, hearing loss, erectile dysfunction, in some cases due to decreased blood supply, and then peripheral vascular disease. Note, ECP is used for heart diseases in USA. Right, so this is basically, we do it for the heart patient, but these are the other things which are benefited and being studied for ED and renal flow in USA. That is, studies are undergoing, and but in China it is used for above indications. This one has originated in China only, so it helps everyone everywhere when circulation fails. And then we have contraindications, and the contraindications, obviously every disease, everyone is not fit for every treatment. And if we have aortic regurgitation, the aortic valve is not okay, you know, and in that case, and or if the patient hypertension, it is blood pressure is more than 180 or 110, then that is a relative indication, because hypertension we first treat with the drugs, and such patients are first stabilized with the medicines with the help of chemistry department, and after that we can take them up for ECP. Then we have uncontrolled arrhythmia. Arrhythmia is when the heart is not beating regularly, there is irregular beats. This is one contraindication, strong contraindication, because in arrhythmias we a machine cannot take the signals. And then heart rate of more than 120 beats per minute, that is tachycardia. In this case, first we see why there is tachycardia, and if controlled with some beta blocker or some levodopa or something other, we can, after controlling that, we can, this is also a relative contraindication. In this case also, we first treat the patient with the medicine, and then we can go ahead with the ECG. Then sensitive skin. Sensitive skin is also a strong contraindication. Patient is very sensitive, and they get some rashes, skin rashes, and acute myalgia, some muscle pains, maybe due to excessive use of steroids or something. Patient have very painful legs. In that case, we can't tie the cuffs, and there is no idea, you know, you can't, tolerate the treatment. Then intervertebral disc problems, if there is a spinal problem and hemorrhage, coagulopathy, thrombophlebitis, acute legs, if you don't have the legs, then you can't tie the cuffs to the legs, and obviously ECP is not possible. Then uncontrolled congestive heart failure is another contraindication. Then patient preoperation, this is you inspect the skin for cuts, bruises, irritation, take all medications as ordered. And if using a diuretic, then we see, you know, take after ECP, no coffee, tea, etc. Before ECP, no food or drink for 1.5 hours before ECP. That is better to have it, and because empty stomach. And then we have tight fitting, form fitting, undergarments, and we have exercise tights before treatment. Sister notes progress in condition. Patients advised to urinate immediately prior to treatment. They note weight, blood pressure, pulse, saturation rate. Patients are advised, if uncomfortable, inform immediately. Patient demonstrated the use of alarms, which if any problem, patient has to keep an angina diary daily. Patient is encouraged to talk freely with the staff for better treatment. The treatment, patient wears his tights and he lies on a padded bed. Electrodes are applied to the chest. Plethysmographs also placed on finger or ear that takes the pulse of the flow, and compressive air tights. Cuffs are wrapped around each leg, calf, thighs, buttocks, and upper arm. And this is the step to success. And the machine is switched on by the doctor, and the machine has controls with the compressor that pumps the air. And simply the patient has, and they create the positive pressure and the negative pressure, and they are inflated and deflated according to the heart rate. Cuffs inflate, deflate, microprocessor diamond controlled inflation during diastole by compressed air. The sequentially cuffs, thighs, buttocks, deflation just before systole by negative. Simple science, you know, the physics, people can understand it more. And these pressures and weights, and this is the one thing is done, ECG, heart rate, counter pulse. This is the ECG, this is what the doctor is seeing on the monitor. This is ECG remains same, but when the counter pulse is applied, the plethysmograph shows how this was a normal pulse, and now it increases and becomes a counter pulse is bigger than the main pulse. So this is external counterpulsation. This is a graph. Once this is achieved, we know that the machine is working fine and the pressures are fine, and the desired results will be achieved. and these are inflation deflation wall signals which show that when there is deflation and when there is inflation. And these things, the augmented SEC device, is you know, keeps you showing and how the counter pulses are formed, and these things are recorded also along with the heart rates and the other parameters. ECP mechanism is something technical, and cuffs inflate electronically, timed during diastole using QRS signal, and they deflate, blood is forced retrograde into the arteries and back into the aorta, higher pressure is in ascending aorta transmitted to coronaries. Repeated increased pressure and flow, and there is vasoendothelial GF etc. secretions, they stimulate formation of new blood vessels that cause angiogenesis. Angiogenesis means new blood vessels are formed, and that is where we call it natural bypass. And then repeated increased pressure and flow, the blood vessels dilate, dormant blood vessels, they open up. With the dilatation, that gradually becomes a permanent factor, and then the supply to the myocardium, it increases permanently. It is not only during the time of pressure. And the, when they deflate, decreased vascular impedance and ventricular workload decreases, and increased cardiac output is a benefit we get. Then the hemodynamics of ECP, it increases blood flow to the heart, brain and other vital organs. To be short, heart 20-42%, brain 22-26%, kidneys 19%. Increases heart's output, stroke volume by 12%, reduces afterload, and increases left ventricular ejection fraction. That is a big issue. LVF increase, EF, once this increases, the patient directly feels much better, and the angina and all the degrees or very little is left. Improves memory, renal function, and erectile dysfunction, etc. Then assessment, how do we know the patient is better? They feel better and they test better, they reduce frequency of chest pain, reduce intensity of chest pain, and reduce need for medication. Increased exercise tolerance, and there is improved quality of life. Improved sense of well-being, they walk around happy, nothing like wellness there is. And they test better, the DMT and all, they confirm the success of the treatment. And then we have these thallium pictures, and in this, nuclear studies, like pre and post, they test show how their perfusion was less and how after the treatment it has increased in those areas in post ECP. So these are the different ways how we document the success. And then we have a cardiovascular cartography, the myocardial blood flow profile. This is in this pre-ECP picture, we see these yellow parts where there was a decreased blood flow in the three right and left main and circumference arteries. And here, the after the ECP, those areas have normal perfusion. And in this case, only 2% and 4% reduction is left. That is a very good, successful reporting. So, we are proving, not guessing, the success, and plus patient feels it before test they measure it. And this is angiography, how the vasculature has increased. And these are again the legs in the how the perfusion has increased. Here we have less before circulation, and here the circulation has increased. And duration of effects, how long this last, beneficial effects last for 3 to 7 years or longer, even 9 years. This is what books have reported. You're up to 90% patients improve, and they are okay for 3 to 7 or even 9 years. In USA, insurance reimbursement is there, and ECP insurance has reimbursement has gone up by 6%. Angioplasty, CABG, etc., decreased by 7% after the ECP has been introduced. And then we had some mental blocks. How can it be, you know, so comfortable? So is it useless? We have not read about it. How can such easy concept work? Mental blocks, and is it adequately? No, this is not. If from East is suspect, this is where such webinars play a crucial role in spreading the right information in the right direction, and most of the heart patients can benefit from it. And thank you. Now we can, I can answer, take any questions if there are.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much. Ma'am, many of the participants want to know ECP in short. How will you explain it in short? The benefit of ECP.
Benefit of ECP is, you know, less angina after the treatment, and if you have a chest pain, then you have a lesser requirement for the medicines. No surgery is required. That is the best benefit. This is an alternative to surgery.
Okay. Thank you, ma'am. It means
to avoid bypass surgery.
Okay. To avoid bypass surgery, we can go for ECP.
Yeah. If you are scared of surgery or you don't want it.
Those who do not want heart surgery, they can go for ECP. Since many of the persons are not able to go for the surgery, there are many physical problems are there. So they cannot go for the heart surgery. So they can go for ECP, which is non-surgical process to clean heart blockage.
Yes, yes.
And it increases the blood flow. Am I right, ma'am?
Huh?
Am I right? I'm saying right.
Yeah. Yes, yes. Absolutely right.
It also increases blood flow.
Yes.
Not in only in the heart, but also in brain and vital organs.
Yes, kidneys and all also. Yeah.
Its effect is up to 3 to 7 years.
Yeah, that is the lasting effect. After that, it can be repeated.
Okay, after 3 to 7 years, they can again go for ECP.
Yes, we have people coming after every 3 years. They are good and they have been off any medicine, and every 3-4 years they come for the full session.
Okay, ma'am. One of the participants is asking, what is Parkinsonism? Parkinsonism.
Parkinsonism is a different disease where we have shortness of the rigid faces and the tremors in the hands, and it is related to some chemical imbalance in the brain. But such people, they do benefit with ECP.
Okay, ma'am. One of the query is cause of hypertension. Someone is asking cause of
hypertension. First of all, stress in the life is number one, and then is the
diet.
Hypertension is when the arteries are thickened, and there is increased pressure, and at times it is related with the renal problems also. Kidneys are one of the cause, problem in the kidney, and at times it is essential hypertension, where there is no cause is known, but the blood pressure is there, and it normally increases with age, and it sets in with time. And the dietary effect, once there is excessive use of oils and fats and such food, they cause some blockages, and gradually calcium deposits in the blood vessels, vessel walls, and then other things that are responsible are like tobacco use and smoking, because they damage the vascular health. Endothelial health is damaged in that.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am, for sharing your valuable information.
Okay. Any other question, please?
No, ma'am. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you.
Now it's my turn. I'm Dr. Reena Kumari, Assistant Professor, Department of Chemistry, Mirza Ghalib College, Gaya. And I'm very fortunate to be the part of this webinar. And I would like to thank my college principal sir, secretary sir, vice principal sir, my HOD, my colleagues, my participants, and my dear students. Topic is role of science and technology for human health. It has been observed in modern era that technological innovation is very helpful for mankind. The development of science and technology requires patience. Research in the field of human health can take years to produce the results. We live in the age in which the power of science becomes evident every day. A better quality of life, advancement in the medicine and public health contributed to an increase in the life. Next, please. All the science and technology help to release the situation. Diseases known for a long time are still killing the poor and deprived. We have to deal with the diseases of society suffering from problem typically for developed country, such as heart disease, in a mental violation disease of the third is diabetes, among others. Next, please. The most common type of medical devices found nearly every home are used for delivering medication are used for the first aid, such as thermometer. We can find thermometer in everyday life that is available in everyone's house. Next, please. A stethoscope. We are very familiar with the stethoscope. And next is blood glucose meter. If a person is suffering from diabetes, they can measure their glucose level staying at home. Next, please. Blood coagulation meter. Here you can measure your blood coagulation by this device. Pulse oximeter. This is pulse oximeter. You can measure your pulse by this oximeter. Next, please. Electrocardiogram. This shows the blood pressure of person and heart rate. APR monitor. This shows the heart rate of any person. Next, please. Medication administration equipment. There are many medication administration equipment. Such devices used to administer medication in table, liquid or aerosol form. There are many test kits. These test kits used for measuring presence of various chemicals in blood or urine. First aid equipments. This equipment used to cure for injury or temporary condition. Assistive air technology device. It used to enhance person capability such as answering ability or mobility. Next, please. durable medical equipment. It includes medical devices used to support performance of basic activities of daily living. Treatment equipments. This type of equipment used to administer various medical therapies. There are many infect care devices. It includes machines used to monitor and treat infants. Next, please. Medical industry needs to improve the health of general public in India, and it also needs to reduce the cost of providing healthcare. Medical devices needs to be designed to be safer, more accessible and usable and available for tomorrow people. Thank you so much. I would like to invite Dr. Irfana Nahid to share some of her views on the topic. Over to you, madam.
First of all, good evening to all of you, sir, and heartily welcome to Sir N.K. Tiwari, sir, S.S. Sibia, sir, Harpreet Kaur Sibia, ma'am, my secretary, sir, principal, sir, H.O.D., sir, and all the participants who participated in this topic, that is role of science and technology for human health, that is global priority. Next, please. It could be argued that all of the ways technologies has improved the lives of human across the globe, none are as important as the technological advances in medicine, from the invention of X-ray machines to advances in surgical practices. Technology has made us healthier and increased the life expectancies. As we move further into the 21st century, we continue to develop technologies like cure illness and improve our quality of life. Health informatics is heavily integrated with technology and graduates with a Master of Science in Health Informatics degree can help to push the boundaries of healthcare throughout their careers.
Next, please.
Especially, there are five ways technologies is improving health.
The next slide, please.
That is, first is electronic health records. The movement towards electronic health records is a huge evolution in the medical field and one that can facilitate the countless advances in medical diagnostics and treatment. In the past, hospital had disparate information systems that were clumsy in their ability to share and transfer patients' records. With the advent of EHRs, many systems have been connected, allowing for faster information transfer and more integrated and efficient care. Next, please. And these are the ways, that is, of EHRs through which we have the records of the patients. Next, please. The second is telemedicine, that is telehealth. Telemedicine refers to method of advancing healthcare based on telecommunications technologies. There are several reasons telehealth is becoming more popular and successful. First, if we are talking about in rural areas where access to hospitals and other health related services are lacking, patients can use their computer to meet virtually with a doctor. Secondly, the cost benefits associated with health telehealth are substantial. According to an Alliance for Connected Course study, telehealth services can save up to $100 per doctor visit. Another study published in Chest Journal shows patients in an ICU equipped with telehealth services were discharged 20% faster and had a 26% lower mortality rate than traditional ICUs. Next, please. And these are the ways of telemedicine, or we can say that is telehealth. Next, please. And the third point is, which is very important, that is remote monitoring tools when patients monitor their health at home. Nowadays, in every home, this type of remote monitoring tools are available. They can save money and reduce unnecessary visits to the doctor office. At the end of 2012, almost 3 million patients worldwide were using home health monitoring system. Pacemakers for patients with heart diseases can automatically send data to remote health centers. Great for patients with chronic illness. These tools can allow systems to monitor a patient's health from a distance. Next, please. And these are the machines which we use in our day-to-day life, especially that is machines used for the BP. Next, please. That is wearable technology. The wearable medical device market is growing quickly, and these devices collect data which help doctors and patients alike monitor and assess the health of the wearer. In addition to devices that alert authorities about serious medical issues, there are very popular wearable like wristbands and watches that are allowing users to take an active role in their health. According to Huffington Post, by 2018, an expected 130 million wearable devices will have been shipped to consumers. Next, please. Next, please. That is at last, that is genome sequencing, and some have called personal genomics the future of healthcare. Personal genomics refers to the sequencing and analysis of one person's genome and then giving that person his or her genomic information. Sequencing the human genome has been one of the greatest advancements in the medical technology of the last 40 years. Dr. Francis Collins, director of the National Institute of Health, says in modern healthcare, for all human history, we have labored with understanding our instruction book, and the human genome provided that. And it's like crossing a bridge. The technological advances in the medical field have allowed for many life-saving procedures to become commonplace. Just the thought of virtually visiting a doctor from hundreds or thousands of miles away would have been difficult to believe only a few decades ago. From remote monitoring tools and wearable medical technology to the sequencing of genome, technology is improving health at a rapid pace. Next, please. And we can see the example of whole genome sequencing of coronavirus. Next, please. That's all. Thank you. Thank you, sir. All.
Thank you, Madam Irfana Nahid, for providing her valuable opinion on the topic. Now I would like to invite Dr. Sujat Ali Khan sir, Vice Principal, Mirza Ghalib College, Gaya.
Very good evening to all. In this resounding success webinar, where the topic was role of science and technology for human health, and it's a global priority. Before I have been assigned a tough job to offer thanks to all, I must say one thing, that a willing mind can turn impossible to possible. That Dr. Reena, supported by Irfana, proved. Yesterday, when they came to me, at that time there was not such a big plan to go with this program, but they accepted the challenge and given by a force. I would like to mention the force later on, and they proved this, that a willing mind can do anything. You can achieve everything if you have a willing mind, firm commitment, that they proved. I must offer my heartfelt thanks to Mr. N.K. Tripathi, Chief Patron and Vice Chancellor, Malwanchal University, Indore, Madhya Pradesh, who, despite his busy schedule, found time to grace this occasion. I salute you, sir. I offer my heartfelt thanks to you, sir, that you have encouraged all the participants to be the part of this webinar on this very scenario of COVID-19. And we are talking about science and technology. Sir, this seminar with this brief question and session has given a new dimensions, though it was a very brief, that we can go for a big platform where we can discuss a lot regarding our health issues. I must offer my heartfelt thanks to Dr. Subinder Singh CBR, the keynote speaker of today, whose words of kindness, interest, hospitality and support has made this very webinar a very informative one. And I must quote his punchline, that science, the hope for patients. Really, sir, it is only science which is the hope of patients of yesterday and today and tomorrow too. I must offer my heartfelt thanks from the core of my heart to Dr. Harpreet Kaur Sibiya, the chief speaker, for her valuable contribution and informative approach, informative words, especially related to heart ailments, where we have learned a lot, because everybody is today, to some extent, they are living, one is living one's life in a fear psychosis of heart problem. It's very important to discuss. We need, again, such a platform where we can discuss every aspect of heart ailment that can help us to reduce or in the curing of this ailment. I must offer my thanks to all the participants, especially who joined this group, who joined this program in a very short notice. And they paid a patient hearing to all of our speakers. The man behind this, behind the screen, though he was off the screen, I must thanks to Mr. Shabbi Arfin Shamshi, the chairman of this very webinar, and Secretary Mirza Ghalib College Gaya, for his stewardship, support, vision, commitment and a motivational force, that it was he who made this program today. With his encouraging words, the two rhyming words, Reena and Fana, took a challenge and made this very webinar a memorable one, a resounding one. I must offer my special thanks to Mr. Professor Jalaluddin Ansari, the principal of the college and the patron of this very webinar, whose valuable contribution, guidance and encouragement made the program a successful one. I should not miss by mentioning three names of this advisory committee constituted of three persons, Dr. Shahabuddin, Dr. Raghib and Dr. Afsar. I owe my gratitude to them that they supported all these two force, I can say Reena and Irfana, to make the program a successful one. Now I must, last but not the least, once again I would like to offer two names. Dr. Reena, supported by Dr. Irfana, for their hard work, for their pains taking to make the program, for arranging, for organizing, and showing that one can do when one wants to do. I must term them as a Venus William and Serena William of my college, that the two gave a new direction and they showed that one can frame the things and one can achieve the things. Last, I must offer my total thanks to all those persons of the scheme who supported these two girls, Reena and Fauna, the assistant professor of my college, just to make this program a successful one. By offering the thanks, I would like to offer my total thanks to all, and I would like to conclude by offering the lines of Robert Frost, that's, "Woods are lovely, dark and deep, but I have promises to keep, and miles to go before I sleep, and miles to go before I sleep." Thank you all.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, Sujat Ali Khan, sir, Vice Principal, Mirza Ghalib College, Gaya. Thanks, sir, for appreciating us. And under your guidance, sir, we will achieve. We are looking for more achievement, and we need your blessings. Thank you, sir. I would like to invite our honorable secretary, sir, Sabi Arfin Samsi, sir. I would like to say about him. He is very young, active and energetic personality. It's our honor to have you, sir, in our college. We are very fortunate to work under your supervision, sir. Though he has many achievements in his life, one of them are, he has been awarded by the Certificate of Appreciation by the Prime Minister of many countries such as UK and South Asian countries. He has provided heartiest service during the lockdown period to the person who needed food and clothes and a deprived person. Sir, over to you, sir.
Good evening to everyone. Myself, Shabbi Shamsi, Secretary, Mirza Ghalib College. Mirza Ghalib College is in Gaya. Gaya is known with both Gaya and is a very important place. I think everybody is aware of it. Bodh Gaya, where Buddha got enlightenment. So, we are connected with Bodh Gaya. And this is a very important place. Mirza Ghalib College is a post deficit program, post graduate minority college affiliated to Magad University. Now I want to thank all the participants, especially Mr. N.K. Tripathi, Vice Chancellor and ex-DG. Mr. Tripathi, it was very nice to hear you. I am also connected with the police. Few of my friends were of your batch of 1974. Now they have died. But it's a pleasure for me to see you and very active. And you were continuously sitting on the chair from the initial time. Very nice to hear you, Mr. Tripathi. And hope we will be in touch with you. My lot of thanks to Dr. Sukhbinder Singh and Dr. Harpreet Kaur. You have made us aware. You have made us aware about the heart. How we can keep our heart young. This is very important. So we have to take care of our heart. And we think we have got enough knowledge by your talk. And one very important thing which we came to know from Dr. Sukhbinder and Dr. Harpreet Kaur is the CBR Medical Center. Now, it is there in our mind. Whenever it is needed, one can visit the CBR Medical Center. Thank you again, Doctor, both of you. And now I want to thanks to the team of Mr. Ghalib College who has taken pain to organize this webinar, and especially to Dr. Reena, Assistant Professor, Chemistry Department, and Dr. Irfana, who has taken a lot of pain to organize this webinar in just a day. Thanks a lot to them and hope that they will come up with flying colors in their life. I also thank my Principal Mr. Jalaluddin Ansari, who is of 60 but going on as if he is 40. He is a very energetic person, sitting from morning till evening, taking lot of pains for doing the best for the college. And at last, my dynamic, young, and all the adjectives I can use for Mr. Shujaat Ali Khan, who is the Vice Principal of Mirza Ghalib College. And he is the last one to leave the college regularly. So again, I thanks all the participants and especially to both the doctors for showing us the CBR Medical Center. And I think if we need in future, we will be helped from CBR Medical Center. So again, thankful to you both, Dr. Harpreet and Dr. Sukhbinder Singh. And Mr. Tripathi, everybody who has taken part in this webinar, thanks again to all of you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you, everyone. Now I would like to take your leave, sir. Thanks, sir.
जो दिल के रोगी बाईपास सर्जरी स्टेंट या एंजियोप्लास्टी के योग्य नहीं, बाईपास फेल हो गया हो या करवाना नहीं चाहते, उनके लिए FDA अमेरिका प्रमाणित ECP और आर्टीरियल डिजीज क्लिनिक लंदन तकनीक अनुसार ACT कीलेशन थेरेपी उपलब्ध है। इस इलाज प्रणाली द्वारा दिल के दर्द तथा एंजाइना से राहत मिलती है।
Thanks for watching. Please like, comment, subscribe and ring bell for notification of latest updates.